Morning.
Morning.
This is the day that the Lord has made.
Let us rejoice and be glad in it.
Let us worship God.
Hello, everyone. Let's stand and sing. Praise you, the Lord, the Almighty.
God's grace, let us confess our sin.
Merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart and mind and strength. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. In your mercy, forgive what we have been, help us to amend what we are, and direct what we shall be, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Anyone who is in Christ is a new creation. The old life has gone, a new life has begun. Know that you are forgiven and be at peace. To move around and greet our friends and neighbors.
Good morning, friends. Peace be with you. Peace be with you, too. Peace, everybody.
Thank you.
Peace, Heather.
Peace. Peace. Well, good morning, good morning. So good to be back with you after a summer break, including the focus services. I haven't been at worship with Westminster for 5 weeks, and too long. Nice to be back in the groove. Lots to catch up on in this room. Special welcome to my daughter Rosa. Our just love it when Rosa is here. She's flying back to Reno this afternoon. But we got to intersect a little, and she got to see the Northwoods Forest for a few days. Welcome to everyone's here. Welcome, Anna, Belinda's niece, which I guess that makes you Maxine's cousin. Is that right? So welcome visiting. So great to have you here. Anybody else who would like to be especially welcomed? Welcome to each of you. Lots to catch up on. People are in transition here. Ephraim's going to college in like 8 days. A week from Thursday. So that's very exciting. And some of you have been to camp. Caleb and Andre and Choice have been to camp since I was here, and we need to really hear about that soon. Don't worry, not at this minute, but we want to catch up on that. And some of you have traveled hither and yon, and we want to catch up on that. Chris sang at SPAC last night. Carmina Burana, which is like a heck of a piece to sing. Could we do that as special music sometime?
We'll think about it.
Yeah. Just like maybe just excerpts from Carmina Burana, just as an offertory. Okay, yeah. No, but what a thing to do that and to still have voice to come here this morning. I know you're not singing a solo this morning, but we are glad that you lived through Carmina Burana. Any other announcements that need to be made? Next Sunday's worship will be even more delightful than this Sunday, as delightful as this Sunday is, because Andrea Holroyd is going to be leading us in a discussion service, and you guys are going to be singing together, and Nancy and Andre are going to do a duet, and that would be really special. And then in 2 weeks, we are going to worship out in Henry Hudson Park on the Hudson River, right near Marie's house, if you're wondering where we'll be. Just go to Marie's house and turn left. That's it for us in this downstairs arrangement. The first Sunday in September, which is September 2nd, we are hosting the Focus Combined Church Service, and we're going to be up in our sanctuary, and we're going to have a really special service because we are going to be featuring music in that service, including some of the musicians from the other Focus churches. Now, more about that as we approach that time. But with that, let me just say It's really good to be here. We are worshiping at tables, as you have noticed. That's going to give us a chance to talk with each other at the tables, which we will do in a few minutes. Some of you know, the church that I served prior to coming here, the church I served in Maryland, worshiped at tables in this kind of arrangement at least once a month, and more often sometimes. And so it's sweet for me to be back in this arrangement, but I also really enjoy this in this room, because this is how we serve the Focus breakfast on Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday mornings. And I love the idea that we worship in the same place that we serve. And that's what we're doing today. And really, in this building, that is what we do every Sunday. What a privilege it is to gather and to serve and to worship with you. Let's continue in worship with the one and only Gail Garrison.
Want this mic?
Together say the prayer of illumination. God of all power, open our ears, our eyes, and our hearts with a spirit of wisdom and revelation. Help us to hear your voice, to see your ways, and to receive the joy of truth. In Jesus' name, amen. Our scripture lesson for this morning will be taken from Paul's letter to the Ephesians, the book of Ephesians chapter 4, from the verse 25, and then we conclude at verse 5, sorry, we conclude at chapter 5, verse 2. So then, putting away falsehood, Let each of you speak the truth with your neighbor, for we are members of one another. Be angry, but do not sin. Do not let the sun go down on your anger, and do not make room for the devil. Those who steal must give up stealing. Rather, let them labor, doing good work with their own hands, so as to have something to share with the needy. Let no evil talk come out of your mouth, but only what is good for building up, as there is need, so that your words may give grace to those who hear. And do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, with which you were marked with a seal for the day of redemption. Put away from you all bitterness and wrath and anger and wrangling and slander, together with all malice. Be kind to one another, tender-hearted, forgiving one another, as God in Christ has forgiven you. Therefore, be imitators of God as beloved children, and walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself up for us, a fragrant offering and sacrifice to God. This is the word of God. Amen.
Thanks, Lord. May the words of my mouth, may the meditations of our hearts together be acceptable in your sight. For you, Lord, are our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. Well, we're going to take advantage of our configuration this morning and of our slightly more informal feeling in the summer to talk not just before and after the service, but to talk a little bit with each other during the service. Now, Team Ashburn, if you guys just want to talk with yourselves, that's cool. But maybe somebody would like to go over and talk to the Ashburns. If you're looking for a chair, you could join Ashburns over there. Ajay's, I don't know if you want to jump in there. But we're going to start with just like a quick little warm-up question. And this is what I'd like you each to do, to go around one by one at the table and to say, my name is, and then say, this is the question. Well, fill in the blank. I know I'm getting frustrated when. I know I'm getting frustrated when. What signals do you get in your body, in your head? How do you know, oh, I'm starting to get in a frustrated situation? What does it feel like for you? So my name is Heather, and I know I'm getting frustrated when I feel that sarcastic tone start to creep into my voice. Rose is laughing because she knows it well. How about you? Go take a few minutes and then we'll check back in. Okay, those of you who are here on Zoom, you could use the chat to share your name, and you know you're getting frustrated when, or if you want to unmute and go ahead and share with everybody.
Or maybe you never get frustrated.
Okay, I was, it's Valerie. Hi. So I was just gonna do, I was just gonna suggest chat too, but I could start it and just say, I was just thinking about when I'm frustrated, I know I'm getting frustrated when I have to restrain myself from saying something. I recognize that I need to listen before speaking.
This is Margie Mayer, and I know I'm getting frustrated when I can't think straight.
Yes.
And I went to the craft show, and I saw the beer. And
anybody else want to join in? Chat or unmuting and speaking works in this situation. Or just make a note to yourself, and we'll come back in to this reflection in just a moment.
Everyone had a chance to go? Okay, I can see now we're all discussing the frustration. Has everyone at least at the table been able to say their name and... Take your time, Irvin. You good? Did I say that in our sarcastic tone? Bravo. Okay, so, yeah. So here's the thing. In the scripture that we just heard, this is a part of a section of one of Paul's letters, a letter to the Ephesians, as Mark identified it. And there's some wonderful theology in this letter and some deep reflections about the nature of Christ. And then as Paul is wrapping up his letter, there's these sort of like instructions to the community. And it's really about, okay, how are you guys working together as a church community? And here's some, you know, words of advice and counsel to you as a community. And that's something first to keep in mind. This isn't just written to an individual. This is written to a group of people who are trying to do something together. So really written to, for example, everybody together in this room. And, you know, scripture can sort of be one of those tests that regardless of where you are in life, you can read a piece of scripture and something different will pop up to you. Depending on where you are personally. And I don't know what it says about me, but last month when I was planning worship for today, I was very struck that this passage included this instruction, be angry. Now, it goes on to say, be angry, but do not sin, and do not let the sun go down on your anger. Now, that is a piece of scripture that is familiar to me. In fact, it's one of those things that's so familiar, it's a little piece of almost like folk wisdom, and it can be a little surprising to be like, oh, wait, that's actually from the Bible. That's actually there. I thought it might have been Shakespeare or something, or Gandhi, or what. No, here it is. Don't let the sun go down on your anger. But I think that's the piece of this scripture that has been taught to me, or maybe that I have heard. And I haven't really ever paid attention to the first part of the sentence. Be angry. Be angry. Don't sin, don't let it, the sun go down on your anger, but you know what? Go ahead. Be angry. That's not often how we Christians in particular think of our scriptures. There are indeed many scriptures that warn against anger. Proverbs, of course, is very famous for this. There are a lot of proverbs that speak directly to the issue of anger. The one that I always remember is, a fool gives full vent to anger, but the wise quietly holds it back. But the most famous teaching for most Christians about anger, I think, comes from the Sermon on the Mount. And in the Sermon on the Mount, we are taught to turn the other cheek. If someone strikes you on one cheek, turn the other. Blessed are the meek, Jesus says in the beginning of the Sermon on the Mount. And then Jesus continues in the version of the Sermon on the Mount that is in Matthew, and he says this: "You have heard it said, as it was said to those of ancient times, you shall not murder, and whoever murders shall be liable to judgment. But I say to you," Jesus says, "but I say that if you are angry with a brother or sister, you will be liable to judgment. And if you insult a brother or sister, you will be liable to the council. And if you say, 'You fool,' you will be liable to the hell of fire." It's extremely strong instructions about the dangers of anger. And I think for me, and for perhaps many Christians, this has all been filtered in and taught to me as basically a warning against being angry, that anger itself is sinful, that there's something wrong with anger, and that really what a good Christian should be is just patient and kind and meek and mild and humble and all of that. You're laughing. Well, there it is in Ephesians. Be angry. Be angry, but do not sin. Because the truth of the matter is, anger is a human emotion. And the degree to which we have been taught or have somehow picked up from our culture or from other messages that it's not okay to be angry, well, that drives this human emotion that's gonna well up in any single living person. It can drive it underground. There could be this sense that we shouldn't feel what we're feeling. And when dry anger gets suppressed or submerged, what happens? Has anyone here just tried to suppress or submerge anger? Maybe we should speak from our own experience. When you try to do that, what happens? Anyone?
It comes out in a different way.
It comes out in a different way.
Sometimes more inappropriate.
Sometimes it can really blow. Right? The boiling pot that has the lid on it, it gets higher and higher, and then, right? Anybody else? Yeah, Mabel.
Sometimes
that's true. But in order to have our anger motivate us in some way, we have to acknowledge it. So let's talk about what happens when we don't acknowledge it, Gail.
It
can make you sick, right? It can be so internalized that you can become ill from it. Anybody else?
You can pass it on.
You can pass it on.
Yeah, you can hold it in, and you can start teaching lessons to your own kids, and they're going to pass it on that same thing.
That whether or not you're going to acknowledge it, if it's in there, that you start spreading it around, including teaching it to your own children, without actually teaching them what to do with it. Because you didn't know what to do with it. You didn't even acknowledge it was there. Anybody else? You know, you can turn it on yourself. You can think you can be angry with outside forces, and without acknowledging it, you can just become angry with yourself and hurt yourself. It can lead to depression and a very negative internal cycle. It's dangerous not to acknowledge anger. It leads to all sorts of bad consequences. So, friends, when dealing with anger, the first, and I'm no therapist, but it has been very, very, very helpful to me in my life to notice anger. And to notice it not when the pot blows, but to notice it when it's starting. And what feels like frustration or irritation or annoyance, to notice it then and to address it then instead of waiting for it to get extreme. In fact, in the program that I lead at Green Correctional, we do an exercise around this. We call it point of choice. And I won't digress, although sometimes I wish I could do this exercise with the world, but we draw a set of steps. You might even know an exercise like this, where the first step is like irritation, and the second step is annoyance, and the third step is anger, and the next step is rage, and the last step is fury. And we always point out that once you get to fury and rage, most of us have lost control. We can't make any decisions when we're in that place. And so if we want to be able to still exercise choice about what we're going to do with our anger, we need to intercede a little bit lower on that set of steps. That you can intercede, we talk about this in prison, you can intercede up to the point of anger, but it's even easier to act when you're at frustration or annoyance a little bit farther down. And that's the place where you can have some choice about how you're going to deal with your anger. And one of those things that I have found very helpful is to acknowledge that I'm angry. I know that may sound very simple for some of you, but for whatever reason, the culture in which I was raised, I didn't think of myself as angry. And to actually get to the point where I could say, oh, wait, I know what I am right now when I'm antsy and sarcastic and slightly sweaty. Wait, I'm angry. I'm angry. That's what I am right now. I'm angry. Okay, I'm angry. And then to get curious about it. What is behind my anger? Because the truth is, for many of us, anger is a secondary emotion, and we can feel it more easily than we can feel shame or grief or some embarrassment, humiliation. That's behind it. And we don't want to acknowledge those feelings. So instead, we're feeling angry. So we notice it, and then we get curious about it, what's behind it. And sometimes that curiosity, which for Christians we can couple with prayer and reflection, sometimes that will lead us beyond anger. We will let go of an expectation, or maybe let go of some pride, or go back into a conversation with somebody with a deeper intent to listen. And we will take a break and go back in. And some of us may even find that the deeper we go with our prayer life, our spiritual life, the less anger we experience.
We still have points of frustration, but we can engage with a curious spirit about those things, and we become less prideful and more humble, and we become less angry. But friends, today I want to talk about a different kind of anger. I want to talk about a kind of anger that as you develop your spiritual life, as you go deeper in prayer and in your relationship with Christ, you may actually experience more of this kind of anger. And one way to describe this anger is to call it holy anger. And there are very, very positive, powerful examples of this kind of anger in Scripture. Can anybody think of anybody in Scripture who got angry? Jesus did. Somehow we think of that situation with the money changers as like this, I don't know, he had like a weird break at that moment, but that's is part of Jesus was. But on top of it, Jesus railed against hypocrites. It's called people exactly what he saw, and they weren't nice things. Called people out for their bad behavior, and not in a gentle way. Jesus was angry. Anybody else? Yeah, Moses. Moses, at various times, wants to kill all of the Israelites who he has led out of captivity. And actually, on several occasions, asks God to just smite them all. He's completely frustrated with them on not just one occasion. David becomes extremely angry, and Paul, our friend there who is writing this letter, he also rails against people in his letters and against Pharisees. So we have this testimony from Scripture that is impossible to understand. If we see anger only as sin, we need to see it as also a catalyst, as Mabel, you pointed out right away. That there is a kind of anger that the more we are aligned with God's will for this world, the less we can tolerate the things that are against that will, including acts of injustice, greed, cruelty, those things we do not just smile and accept or silently weep over, that they can actually generate in us anger. And that anger then becomes a catalyst. It becomes a prompt for us to speak out, to say something, to do something about that thing that we are angry about. Now, one of my guides in the emotional life, Brené Brown, social worker and a writer, she has sums this up in a beautiful way. She says, anger is a powerful catalyst, but a life-sucking companion. A powerful catalyst. But if you do not act on it, if you don't reflect on it or let it drive you to action, but instead just let it linger around, it is a life-sucking companion. And one of the things we need to do as a community is to follow Paul's advice and to be angry, not to sin, but to be angry about the things that makes God angry. So with that, let me offer a question for you to discuss among yourselves at the tables for just a few moments. What is something that you feel or have felt in the past that you feel or have felt angry enough about that you took some action? Speak up, to fight it, to do something about it.
When have you experienced some of that holy anger, where anger compelled you to speak up or to act? What is something that you feel now or have felt in the past angry enough about that it compelled you to act? Let's all of us just take a moment to reflect on that. And then we're going to take about 5 minutes at our tables to talk about it with each other. So there's probably not enough time to tell the whole story. So just summarize and let everybody have a chance to speak who would like to speak.
Okay, friends, I am going to use the breakout room function here. And if any of you would like to go into a breakout room to talk with each other and share your thoughts on this question, you can accept this prompt to go into a breakout room. If you would prefer not to and you want to just take a few moments, we'll be in this breakout space for about 5 minutes and then come back together. And you just don't accept.
Well, that we could keep going, of course, but what a cool thing to be able to talk about this with you all. I hope you had a chance to connect a little and talk. I feel like it'd be very interesting if we as a church decided to get angry about something. Be angry, but do not sin. Be angry, but do not sin. Do not let the sun go down on your anger. And do not make room for the devil. And maybe one of the ways in which we follow that part about do not make room is to listen to the first part. Be angry. Amen. We're going to pray together now, and we'll lead into that time of prayer with hymn number 833, O Love That Will Not Let Me Go.
Hey!
have connected at tables with each other a little bit, I ask that you would do one more thing. And that is to think of one prayer request for yourself, for somebody you love, for the world, one and one only. Let's take a moment, and our first prayer will be to ask God to direct us to the one thing that we need to lift up as a request this morning. Now let us take a moment, each of us at the table who wishes to share, you can also pass if you would like, to state briefly that concern and share it with your people.
Friends on Zoom, please feel free to share a concern out loud or on the chat, and I can see a couple on the chat. Thank you. Yeah.
me just ask if you have had your chance to share your concerns at your table, just to hold those in silence for a few moments until we all catch up with you. I don't know if anyone hasn't shared who wants to share. Okay, then let's hold all of what has been stated. Imagine that there is at the center of your table a basket or a bowl or some container. And those prayers are in there now. And imagine all of us together lifting those prayers, lifting those baskets up. And remember that God hears our prayers and is with us in our time of need in ways that we know and ways unknown to us. So trusting in God's grace, release that basket, release those prayers, hand them over to God, so that we may together leave this place lighter than when we came. And let us pray together the prayer that Jesus taught us to say, saying, Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
It always seems to me that our offerings reflect our priorities and values. And in Matthew 6, chapter 6, verse 21, it states, wherever your treasure is, there your heart will be also. That always hits home for me. You can make your offering online through the website. You can mail a check to the church office, or I think it's hidden behind the, on that side too, on the stage, so.
Wonder why are we singing My Eyes Have Seen the Glory. This is a wonderful old song. I was trying to think, is there an angry hymn? I looked through our whole hymnal and there's all these things, you know, peace come to me, may I be more peaceful, may the world be more peaceful. I was like, well, what about being angry about something? And then I thought of this hymn. This is a really angry hymn. But this is this righteous anger, this holy anger. So, Emma, we gotta sing. We cannot sing this in a chill way, okay? We got to channel some of that. However you may find it in yourself or in our community, this is an invitation to join in that righteous anger that can move us to action. Let's sing together. My eyes have seen the glory. Thanks be to God.